my pleasure to introduce our first speaker of the morning, Dr. Anna Chodos. Dr. Chodos is one of those wonderful, rare finds. She's a geriatrician, very hard to come by these days. Anna is an assistant professor of medicine in the Division of General Medicine, Internal Medicine at Zuckerberg San Francisco General and the Division of Geriatrics at UCSF. She is the co-principal investigator in the Geriatrics Workforce Enhancement Program, which is training healthcare providers and social service providers in geriatrics principles. She's also the medical director of the Outpatient Geriatrics Consult Service at Zuckerberg San Francisco General Hospital. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Anna Chodos.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much. I'm really pleased to be able to open the conference and really amazed at the enrollment and registration. It's just incredible. I'm also pleased because I feel like Elizabeth and Jackie Spear sort of made my case for me about why this update is important and why we're talking about it this morning. So the 2017 Alzheimer's Clinical Care Guidelines update is a California Department of Public Health guideline that's being promoted on the DPH website. And we really encourage you to use it and promote it as well, because the one thing it doesn't have with it is sort of funds and a mechanism to disseminate it necessarily. So this is a great opportunity. I was part of the group that helped contribute to its development among literally dozens and dozens of other people. So it was really exciting process. Because of time and because of that wonderful letter and just wanting to keep this long but really full day on track, I'm actually going to sort of whiz through a little bit of the beginning, which is the first page of the guideline, which is in your packet right behind my slides. So you can look at the guideline as I'm talking. And the first page of the guideline is its rationale and why this update is happening now. And some of the background, epidemiologic, the government policies, and the emerging practice trends that sort of support doing an update. And so I'm just going to whiz through that a little bit to keep us on track and to get to the meat, which is the clinical care guideline, which is the second page, and which I think a lot of us probably also already know a lot of the reasons for the update. For the clinical care guideline as well, just to point out, it is mostly focused on providers, healthcare providers, in that setting. So here we go. So again, the roadmap, I will quickly go through the disease and its impact background and the evidence for the update, and then try to get us right to the clinical care guidelines. So again, just the main thing I wanted to point out here is that the guideline is an update since it had been updated every 4 years, and then I guess there was a little pause. So it's an update from 2008, which was the last guideline. Excuse me, I'm trying to advance here. Whoops. And I think this is stuff we all know, just whiz by the fact that Alzheimer's is the predominant form of dementia, affecting 68% of people with dementia and affecting hundreds of thousands of Californians. We also know that women are more affected than men, and racial and ethnic minorities, African Americans and Hispanics, have a higher prevalence of dementia. Against a few government policies just to be aware of, and I think probably many of you are, is that there's new forms of Medicare reimbursement to help support our care of dementia, which are a good reason to be aware of the clinical care guidelines and to use them. Since the last update, the PULSED was adopted in California. Similarly, the compassionate allowance benefit for early onset individuals with dementia became possible. And there's a Healthy Brain Initiative launched by the CDC. So these are all things contributing to motivation for the update. Sorry, my clicker is a little slow. So again, the CMS policy was that the annual wellness visit got going. And I don't know how many of you work in settings where they're actually doing that. And there are also new billing mechanisms, and including one passed this year to bill for actual care planning, which is huge, and doing the components of good dementia care, cognitive assessments, functional assessments, and care planning. The Pulse, does everybody know what the Pulse is? Okay. but it's a wonderful thing and adopted since the last update, but it has now been around since, I think, 2008. And then the Social Security Compassion Allowance, for those of you working with people who are under 65 who have a diagnosis of dementia, this is an important benefit. So just to be aware of that. And then the Healthy Brain Initiative. Do any of you look at the materials? I put the link here underneath, but they're great for education and supporting lifestyle modification in folks who have dementia or to prevent dementia. So just want you to be aware of that. And again, I'm very aware, I'm whizzing through this. And then practice trends and, So emerging practice trends, as Elizabeth was saying, there's actually two really important things. One, we want to be emphasizing earlier detection to provide better care to people, prevent poor outcomes. And the gaps in disclosure and documentation is a huge issue that's gotten more and more attention and more research showing just how big those gaps are. So these are the reasons that this guideline could hopefully be really helpful. The other thing is we've had additional data about the danger of antipsychotic medications in people with dementia, and more studies, of course, many of them coming from Europe, about the wonders of some lifestyle modifications like diet that can help support healthy brains. So, again, the antipsychotic medications, I think many of us know that there's now a black box warning about increased mortality with some of the antipsychotic medications. I'm sorry, actually all of them. And that we want to be really careful with these medications. So this is something that are still overused, but were more overused before. And we really want this to be part of good care that people know about the dangers of these medications. And then, as Elizabeth said, 45%, probably higher in many settings, of people who are billed actually don't have the diagnosis disclosed or not aware of the diagnosis. And then, as already mentioned, many people don't even have it detected. So we want earlier detection. We want good documentation. And then lifestyle modifications. As I mentioned, we've appreciated much more based on excellent research in the last 7 to 10 years about how cardiovascular risk modification can really help guard against progression of dementia and hopefully prevent dementia, tobacco cessation, weight management, regular exercise, and diet. Okay, now we're at the clinical care guidelines, and thank you for letting me be a little brief on the background so that we could get to this part and keep the day on track. And again, this is the second part of your guideline. And the clinical care guideline is broken down into 4 parts: assessment, care plan, education and support, and important considerations. And so for the first part, assessment, with this sort of subtitle, understand the patient. So the first part of that is assess the patient. It seems obvious, but actually this is a huge sticking point, I think, for a lot of providers in healthcare systems. Not only, to assess, but how to assess properly for a cognitive complaint or concern for dementia. So the goal is to encourage people and providers to confirm, disclose, and document the diagnosis. So those are the 3 main elements of diagnosis. We wanted to also emphasize that the patient's culture, values, literacy level, language, and decision-making preferences are also key components of knowing your patient and understanding your patient. And then the caregiver, of course, if there is one, is a key component to assessing a patient with a cognitive complaint. And so a caregiver assessment is a key part of knowing your patient. Sorry, my clicker. I don't know if it's my thumb or the clicker. And one thing we wanted to make you aware of, which is not actually in the guideline, but are people familiar with the Alzheimer's Association Cognitive Assessment Toolkit? It's really wonderful and has a lot of the elements that you would need to assess the patient and the caregiver. So wanted to just put a shout out to that and make sure you were all aware of it. So then another key component is, you know, it's not, we all know this is a progressive illness. So monitoring and reassessing on regular intervals is a key component of understanding the patient. So upon sudden changes or decline, obviously is a great time for reassessment, but also at least annually to conduct. And of course, we are really emphasizing a functional assessment as well as a cognitive assessment. And the guideline really wanted to promote using tools to assess cognition. So within the document, if you go to it online, there's a live link to the MoCA as one tool, and then it references the AD8 as well. And then in your handouts, we have printed out a series of other assessment tools as well, which include things like the GPCOG, the SLUMS, the MMSE. So those are all for references tools. One thing I tend to tell people is whatever tool you'll actually use is the one to use. So some people find the MoCA is a little long for them, or for the patient population that they're working with, it takes too long. So in that case, there's sort of other tools you could use, but as long as you're using something. And then the other thing, and Elizabeth mentioned this, is to assess comorbid medical conditions, because we know that dementia reframes all of that person's care. So to also monitor and reassess other comorbid conditions as you're assessing dementia. And then, of course, and I think, again, this is not an audience I need to be too heavy-handed about, but assessing emotional, behavioral, and or mood symptoms as well, and to do a thorough medication review, including non-prescription medications, which are often forgotten. And then a home environment assessment at some point to assess safety, care needs, and abuse or neglect can be assessed, of course, in a clinical setting as well, but in the home can sometimes be an important setting to assess for neglect, particularly. So then you have all these elements, you have this assessment, you know your patient, so then what sort of care plan are you gonna form? And the subtitle for this section was beneficial intervention. So we're trying to focus on what we know has an impact. So disease management. So how about managing the actual dementia itself? So progression and stages. So I think a lot of times that's not part of the discussion. There may be a disclosure of diagnosis or some assessment, but actually trying to stage the person is not as emphasized. So we were trying to emphasize that in the guideline. Again, the whole emphasis around managing the comorbidities appropriately, given the dementia diagnosis, is another part of the appropriate management of dementia itself. Consider using appropriate medications for stage of dementia, like cholinesterase inhibitors or the NMDA antagonist. So those are things like Aricept for the cholinesterase inhibitor or Namenda for the NMDA antagonist. And then other adjunctive medications like antidepressants, for example. And then referring to community resources. And that's a whole section, the next section, so I'm not gonna talk too much about that right now. I'm sorry, my thumb is acting up again. There we go. So again, the emotional, behavior, and mood symptoms. This is a huge challenge in the clinical setting, and I'm sure many, many of you can appreciate that. So the thing we really wanted to emphasize is to not reach for the prescription pad to treat an emotional symptom in someone who has a dementia diagnosis, and to really consider non-pharmacologic approaches as the first line treatment. So counseling, working on environment modifications, including, you know, who's the caregiver and if other caregivers can be engaged, simplifying tasks, getting the person on a routine with activities. So all these things that we know in changing the environment can change the behavior of the person with dementia, and really de-emphasizing medications. Involving mental health professionals if they happen to be available or are working in collaboration with your care team. That can be really helpful too, especially to work with the caregiver and the person living with dementia. And then we talked about this a lot, but obviously there is a use for medications when someone's behavior is really challenging and potentially harming themselves or others. And so there was the recommendation to use medications if it's really targeted. So targeting to specific emotions, behaviors, or moods. So this is a big thing that's left off, I think, in a lot of clinical care, is actually indicating why exactly you're prescribing a medication for a behavioral symptom, and following that very clearly. So often it's just prescribed and it's just, you know, agitated or behaviors. But a huge piece of that is, again, to change the behavior of the person with living with dementia, we also need to educate and really shore up the caregivers and educate them, because they're the key to ensuring that the person with dementia's behaviors may improve. So a huge emphasis on that in the care guideline to educate caregivers. Oops, did I skip one? I guess not, forgive me. And then safety issues, of course. So depending on your population, actually we're finding that if we screen for firearms, we're finding it in firearms in people who we sort of, non-veterans, for example. Veterans are the classic population that always gets screened, but we're finding it certainly in non-veteran populations. But reminding providers with this guideline to ask about driving hazards, accidents, wandering, and other fire hazards in the home. And then recommending medical identification for those who wander. And then goals of care. So really exploring this earlier and exploring and documenting preferred intensity of care, feelings about palliative care, end-of-life care, documenting any preferences, and then providing education on those critical documents that we use to record people's preferences and protect their preferences, so advanced care health directives, DNR orders, PULSE, and getting DPOAs documented. And finally, in someone living with dementia, to continue to promote healthy living. So to discuss the evidence supporting risk factor modification around diet and activity, that these are critical pillars to keeping that person and their brain as healthy as possible. And of course, Elizabeth was pointing out the need for research and the fact that is what's going to move us to the next level of being able to treat this disease. So offering that and making people aware of the opportunities. And in the guideline, there's a link to a portal to help people find research studies. Sorry, I didn't anticipate the malfunctioning of my thumb this morning. Okay. So finally, education support. And it looks short. But really, to me, this is the bulk of the work, really. And it's engaging with the community. So connecting people living with dementia and their caregivers to social and community support. So involving the patient in the care planning, treatment decisions, and referrals, but suggesting appropriate home and community-based programs, and linking the patient and caregiver to support organizations. So, you know, number one for me is Alzheimer's Association. I'm constantly handing out their information. And then, of course, other local organizations like Family Caregiver Alliance or culturally sort of language-appropriate resources for people. In the guideline itself, we provide the link to patient and family resources at the California Department of Public Health. But I think we all know a lot of these resources are very local. And so I sort of try to know as much as I can about local resources as well to be helpful. And obviously, I work with our behavioral health team and our social work team. Okay, and then the last part, I don't think we knew quite how to label this, but we're calling it important considerations and time-sensitive issues. And this is stuff around things that we wanted to just call out for their importance in safety and adequate care planning. And so one is, of course, advanced care planning. So not just the health and the goals of care, so the medical and healthcare preferences, but the full advanced care spectrum of advanced care planning, which involves the legal and financial as well. So these, you know, we know how vulnerable our folks are who are living with dementia are to financial legal abuse, and so really trying to protect them. So assisting them with those kinds of care planning. capacity evaluations. We know that people with dementia are much more likely to lose capacity at some point, so making that a part of your assessment and documenting it. Elder abuse, so again, incredibly higher risk among people living with dementia for elder abuse of all kinds. And so being aware of that, responding to red flags, alerting appropriate authorities such as Adult Protective Service or ombudsman. Driving, again, we just wanted to emphasize that we are mandated reporters in the healthcare setting. And for most of us, that means actually that we report a diagnosis of dementia to our Department of Health office, and then they are responsible for working with the DMV on that. And then finally, making sure people are aware of their benefits. So if they're a veteran, they may have additional benefits available to them. Again, the early onset Alzheimer's benefit with the compassion allowance and the Social Security Administration, things like that. So we want to make sure people are getting the entitlements that they are eligible for and are able to make use of them to support them in the community. And are people familiar with 211california.org? Did I hear a yes? Okay. And a no. I heard yeses and noes. But it's a resource for legal and financial resources for people. In California, I spend a lot of time going to CANHR, which I'm now going to, CANHR.org, which has a lot of great resources, especially for long-term care planning, and then legal assistance for the elderly in San Francisco. So it initially felt out of my depths as a healthcare provider to talk to people about this, but I'm getting more comfortable with it, and it's certainly extremely important. I'm sorry, I managed to talk through my whole talk without going through the longer slides. There is a link also to point out in the guideline for the driving reporting. And actually, I was so ambitious, I got through too quickly, but I guess I'm just so excited for the day that I wanted to make sure that everybody else had an opportunity to speak. I think this particular section, we were not gonna have questions. Okay, but we do have a few minutes, so if there's a burning question, I'd love to answer it. Oh, and there's a mic. So the question was, why do 50% of people who have Alzheimer's never get the diagnosis? So from my experience, and this is part of the reason, and actually what I should have said in the beginning, is nobody's expected to do this in one visit. This is a lot of stuff. And the diagnosis of dementia often takes time. And actually, time is a helpful factor is a diagnostic component, right, to see that person potentially slowly decline or even remain stable over time. Because if you see somebody once and they're complaining of some memory difficulty, they also happen to be very depressed, and you treat their depression and it improves, that actually really helps you. So I find that it takes often 6 months, sometimes a year, to really feel confident in a dementia diagnosis. And I think that is a huge part of it, that most providers don't feel comfortable. They certainly understand what dementia is, and when it's at moderate or severe stage, no problem recognizing it. But earlier on, people are uncomfortable delivering the diagnosis because they don't feel like they have enough information yet. And then I sort of feel like it drops off a little bit. It sort of doesn't make it to the what we call the problem list, right? In terms of why people who might have a diagnosis are not told, again, I think it is a discomfort with disclosing the diagnosis, in part because of many providers' discomfort with making the diagnosis and feeling like it's a really solid, firm diagnosis. And we have some, you know, if we had a lab test, if we had, you know, functional imaging that immediately and unequivocally told us that people had Lewy body or Alzheimer's or, frontotemporal dementia, I think people would feel more comfortable. Yes.
Hi, who conducts the assessment? It's been my experience with people that physicians spend 2 minutes, say dementia, and never say anything else based on the mini mental status exam, and they call it, that's it, you have Alzheimer's. Could you elaborate a little bit about how this is conducted and who is conducting it?
Yeah, so you mean specifically the cognitive assessment or the whole assessment? Yeah. Cognitive?
The one that you just described in terms of the whole picture.
Who the whole picture, yeah. Assessing? Yeah, so again, this was meant for healthcare providers and teams, I would say. So I don't think by any means that this whole thing has to be done by a physician, a nurse practitioner, or a physician's assistant. Certainly some elements, or a neuropsychologist, certainly some elements could be done by your care team, like a social worker or behavioral health clinician or even nurse specialists that have some expertise in this area. So I think around cognitive testing and putting that cognitive test into context, I think you certainly want somebody who has some experience and expertise, and that tends to be either a combination of a neuropsychologist and a physician or advanced practice clinician. But I think a lot of this, I mean, certainly functional assessment, we have a lot of our social workers and behavioral health clinicians doing some of our cognitive testing initially, and it tends to be a back and forth, and the physician's often interpreting it or putting it into context. And I, even though neuropsychology testing is extremely helpful and would be a gold standard if we could get it on everybody most of the time, it still needs to be put into context. So I often try to remind people of that if you just have it alone and you don't know the patient and you don't understand their functional abilities, then you shouldn't be making a full diagnosis. Yes.
So I have a question about antipsychotic medications. So, you know, sometimes we inherit clients that have already been on these medications for some time. They may be behaviorally stable. And what criteria do you use, and how do you plan for withdrawal of those medications when it's clinically appropriate?
Oh, what a great question. Yeah, I think we know how frequently these are used, and particularly in long-term care settings. So it's not an uncommon thing to get a patient who's on it or to start someone on it. And so I do understand that. So my general feeling is, good practice, good hygiene around using it is, one, to have an informed conversation with the family. So one thing, and the patient. So one thing would be to revisit that with them and to say, do you know why you're on this medication? Do you know the risks that it carries? Did you want to continue? We could trial it off. For me, if somebody's having a really serious behavior and it's really interfering with their safety and others' safety, I document what exactly is happening, what I think it's going to help with. So they're screaming and yelling and hitting and interfering with, you know, basic activities, including eating or, getting dressed or going to the doctor. I'm obviously making up examples, but, I sort of try to document really in a really detailed fashion what's going on. And then I trial the medication. I tend to do it standing, so not PRN, to see if it's really having an effect. And then I follow up, so a month, 2 months. And then after several months, particularly if the behavior is better, I revisit it. Do you think it's worth doing a trial? Take it off and see if the behavior is still happening. We know the disease is progressing, so we know the behaviors are likely to progress and even maybe go away. So I basically, at least a six-month interval, I would revisit whether or not it's worth doing a trial off. And of course, the low and slow principle always applies, starting at the lowest dose possible and not escalating quickly. I'm out of time, unfortunately. I am, it's my first .lastname@ucsf.edu, and I'm happy to be in contact with any of you if you have any questions. Thank you so much for your attention, and I hope you feel like this is useful and you can use it.